One sentence novel. Check it out. Give it up one more time for Ashley, everybody. And the free jazz. Can we? Yes, there it is. Love is in the air here tonight at Easy Paradise. Let's get Lee Moore up. Can we get Lee Moore up to read some poetry for us, everybody? The great, great, great Lee Moore.
Hi guys. That was fun. I didn't know if I was gonna come today, but I was here, and I decided to come see you all.
Yeah.
I'm glad I did. Okay, I feel like I have to set this up a little bit. This is a raw moment in life. So, I was in a relationship with someone who I had to leave them because they were an alcoholic, and we've been not together for a while. And they loved each other very much, and their birthday's coming up, and this makes me uncomfortable. So I wrote, no one relates to that at all. So I wrote this poem about my feelings about it, and then 2 days later, he was outside my building calling my name. He's never done that before, so that was fun. So. I wrote multiple poems to deal with the feelings around this, so that's what you're getting from me today.
Yeah.
You know, so you're so quiet. So the first one is the before, and the second one is the after. Your 37th birthday is upon us, and in my body I can feel I'm still waiting to open the elevator door one afternoon and you'll be passed out inside in your own vomit. No, it is not a good idea to wish you a happy birthday. Last summer when you told me, I hate myself, I love you. When we remembered the boat and the thunderstorm we fucked in, I almost died. I vomited on the boat very quickly in the Elafiti Island morning. Apparently I get seasick now. You were the only person who saw that part of me, and it was gutting. Learning to live without your care, without the ice cubes you laid across the black and blues, mapping the backs of my thighs weirdly symmetrical after I jumped off the cliff and hit the water like sitting in a chair. I had realized I hadn't been that scared in a while. Please be quiet, thank you. This is too important. I had realized I hadn't been that scared in a while, and I asked you I should jump straight like a pencil, right? And you said, well, bend your knees a little. But I think I was so afraid in my body that even if I wanted to, I wouldn't have been able to jump right. I just wanted to fold in on myself, which is a thing I so rarely want. Then last summer, I wanted it again when you told me you would give anything to be back on the boat, except this time I was separate from you, and it was right. And I will not see you when I attend the ballet. I am there for girls in bathing caps, smoking cigarettes, and a sailor dreaming. What will your birthday be anyway? You'll be working. The ballets will be partita, playtime, and love letter on shuffle. I am angry that you will hear James Blake on your birthday. You don't deserve to hear James Blake on your birthday, but you won't hear it anyway. You're so deadened, and all I've been wanting is to sensitize myself to feel fully but have peace in my heart somehow all at the same time.
Yeah.
Real shit. Yeah, we worked at New York City together. He's a carpenter. And this is an after that I wrote yesterday after a kind of wild drive home from Brooklyn. I'm gonna die tonight on the Major Deacon Expressway, barreling toward Van Cortlandt Park East, blasting Alive by Pearl Jam. That's what was on, I think. I love Eddie so much. I'm gonna die tonight catching glimpses of the Empire State Building, black and white like in a comic book, you know, of the Chrysler Building, of the Pepsi Cola sign. I'm gonna die tonight. What's the biggest expression of emotion imaginable? It's saying, I'm gonna die tonight because I'm the opposite of you. No, you're gonna die. Not tonight, but you're gonna die soon. with your ribs hard under my hand, how I want to hold them again as you sleep temporarily, not forever, how I wish you would eat. But I loved your ribs then and now still. I looked in your face and told you, you're gonna die. You came here, so this is what you get. Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Fantastic. Give it up for Lee Moore, everybody. The great Lee Moore, thank you. Is Bradman out there? Bradman, are you still here? Bradman, give it up for Bradman, everybody. Great poet, give it up. Give it up. We're lucky to have Bradman.
What's up, y'all? What's up, y'all? All right, all right. I'm here to do a quick piece and then get the hell out of the way. And if these two wonderful poets that I saw earlier tonight leave, right before I go on, I'm going to break down on the stage and cry. Oh my gosh.
We're chilling.
Yo, I can't believe y'all are still here. This is incredible. Check it out.
What's your name?
New York City is boot camp.
Thank you.
Barely living off food stamps.
Hell yeah.
Too damp, humid fumes, fuel and nude roof tans and stoop jams. This heat is hot. It's a tire fire, burning rubber, melting pot, smoking pot. Either way, it's burning. Keep that spark all day after dark, earning. We're determined. It's the only way to make it without jumping off the Times Square bleachers naked. You gotta know what you want and take it. Fake it like you own every edifice, cause this city here is a motherfucker like Oedipus. Hold up. We are delayed because of train traffic ahead of us. I mean, that's what they said it was. The MTA is not exactly dropping facts, more like the train dropping bodies. Crack! Now here's some wax sacks while they clean up the tracks. This city is war. Truly. You don't live here. You do a tour of duty.
Yeah!
Sort of cute, but worn and moody, torn between the two. Like, I wore and tore my new jacket, snagged it like a jackass on a nail, like a thumbtack, attacked it from the plywood, lining the sidewalk, where I'd walk by hard hats, causing a racket, ripped my back like a packet of ketchup. But catch up, because if you can't handle that destruction from the construction obstructing your path, you can't hack it. It's not the big apple your mom put for a snack in a bag lunch when she packed it, you dig it? If you can't take your lick, split. There's no Jiminy Cricket. Southwest.com, click it and book a ticket.
Yeah.
There are other places to live. Places that forgive. New York does not forgive you. Woo! It forgets you. Woo! It'll forget you ever existed the second your apartment is listed. Woo! Before you even kiss it goodbye. The city's eating Thai with some new guy. Suit and tie and a super-sized gluten-free soup and rice and a high-priced high-rise. And surprise, his prying eyes are scooting real close to a prize, glutes and thighs the second you disappear. But this city forgets you're even here. There's 8 million people, or is it 9? There's 9 million people. If you're not out there catching the deep ball, you're just playing street ball. These roads are not just where your feet fall. This pavement has meaning. Meaning, you don't live where it's so hot or so freezing, depending on the season, without a damn good reason. I mean, let's be blunt. Yeah. Rent is $9,000 a month. You buy a weekly Metro card, swipe it once, spend 7 days waiting for the F train to finally come. You meet someone, you're lucky to get 2 dates. Your upstairs neighbors are basically your roommates. Can't see the stars. Too many cars. Too many bars to get sauced in. City you can lose your mind and get lost in. You want the good life? Move to Boston. Cheaper cost with winning football to Austin. It's an old poem.
Yeah!
Go somewhere nice. Portland. Denver. Austin. But you know that no matter how hard that Lone Star State flexes, this city is bigger than Texas. It's where you learn what sex is, where it all still feels new for you. This city's a Lexus. The rest is a Subaru. It's like all that putting Milkman against Super Dude. This is the city you know putts in. The city that butts in. The city that'll spill your guts, kick your nuts, and spill your guts in the Hudson. City with a million ways to die in. But nowhere on earth you can feel more alive in.
Yeah.
Am I lying?
Woo!
If you're not in New York, then you're not even trying. Woo! You can hop off the island, I-95, 5-hour bus ride, and arrive in 5 or 6 cities where most of your life isn't spent just surviving. But we're here for a reason. So get busy grinding or get busy driving.
True. Bradman, thank you. Give it up, give it up, give it up. Check out Bradman's music. Get to know Bradman. Say hello. We got a lot of great stuff. All right, we got he's the real Bradman, at the real Bradman. Check out at, and I'm tagging people in the Easy Paradise Mag story. So if you check out Easy Paradise Mag, go to the stories, you can find all of the artists that we've had on the open mic tonight. Can we get Jeff Lawrence up? Jeff Lawrence, been waiting patiently all night. We've got some great performers still to come, everybody. Thanks for hanging out. We're partying. This is the beginning. It's the beginning of the party. We are going to get to everybody. If you are still signed up, we will put you on. Thank you for hanging out. We're going to have a great night. It's a 2-drink minimum, once again. Tip Amanda generously. We're going to get a $1 pizza afterwards if anybody wants to go get pizza after. Or Planet Taco. I live on Planet Taco. I love Planet Taco. That's right.
So you're next. Thank you. Yes,
come in. I'm heading out.
Awesome. Thank you. Thank you.
Good to go?
Yeah.
What's up, guys? I'm Jack. I'm gonna play a song I wrote a few years ago.
Yeah.
I've never played it live, so I might screw it up. So.
Woo!
Yeah.
It's not your fault.
Did I have a light on the show?
Give it up one more time. I mean, sounded great. Beautiful acoustic guitar. Jeff Lawrence, everybody. Now, I do want to apologize. There have been people having a lot of exciting open mic readings. There was an open mic yesterday at a garden in Crown Heights that I just couldn't make. I live in Midwood. I live in the middle of nowhere, so it's impossible for me to get anywhere. But there's a lot of exciting open mics happening, including this Thursday at Pete's Candy Store. There's Secret Pete Society, and you should... Is that right? I'm sorry. Okay, right. Secret Pete's. So you should sign up for that if you want to get in on more awesome poetry open mics. And it's hosted by this next excellent poet. Can we get R.E.G.? R.E.G.'s going to read you some poetry. And check out Secret Pete's this Thursday.
Yeah, Ari.
Okay. That was, I announced it earlier. Use that, I was starting to take it.
All right, yeah, I'm gonna plug Secret Pete's. We are on Thursday at 7 p.m. There is a theme every month. It's like the password of the month. So this month is Slayer, whatever that means to you.
Yeah,
I might be bringing a poem with a Buffy reference. It might show off my really trashy Buffy tattoo or something. So come out. You can DM me on Instagram, virtually R-E-G, to sign up. All right. I'm going to read you guys something that if you were at Pete's a couple weeks ago or if you were at the reading here last Wednesday, you've already heard, but just wanted to give it a third go. Your God is a terrorist. Sleep on secondhand smoke, capitalist pheromone aftershave. Heresy's what we call it. Accepting all the rules, quid pro quo. Intestines eat tapeworms, bodily transit is delayed. Dust the snifter, graduated cylinder. Pour to sniff, you finish the line. Leaves a woman on red since she's his age. Faux adulthood rides his shoulders like a child on a piggyback ride. The audacity of the life he lives. Self-identified, highly sensitive person. Velcro for his bootstraps, glad-handing girls. No talk of his once shadow dream. Exposed brick apartment, laughing toddler could run his own business, build his own heart if only he'd try. Yeah, he'll dangle that someday dirty carrot on the box of condoms he hides before you arrive. Men made like hagstone dominoes, hide and seek toxic masculinity is being alive. Blame women's liberation for lost dreams to own a home. When courage is the cheapest beer, and men over any age drink only IPAs. Calls himself a pseudo-intellectual cum artist, says Slava was his one true love. Erotic commedia dell'arte fantasy, fake maudlin intimacy, his is a void filled with cement shoes and lies. His tale's a sob story for psychos, and he's too self-actualized to live his life. But how romantic the notion to fall in slutty love, when sex is just a post-postmodernist, post-feminist, post-structuralist, aging Korean farce. How sweet. And consent is the napkin you spat in when you found a tendon mixed in your meal. See, he's always the victim and the god of his whole world. Man, you're too old for a piggyback ride. Cottonmouth fantasy for a wannabe king. He's the masculine catch-22 in charge. Put the money where the mouth breathes. Son, you were never that smart. He's the elusive artist formerly known as Man Bear Pig, lonesome loner cowboy child looking to ride. Cake on, makeup, post-chemical peel, yeah, he'd happily burn you alive. When he's too exceptional to live aligned, but in little old America, who could blame him for trying? No, here your money has no currency for pride. Send your inner child to summer camp, little cowboy, I don't believe in heresy as life. Your war was object theory fantasy, and I don't negotiate with terrorists. Thank you.
Yeah!
You're recording everything, right?
Yeah, cool.
Yeah!
Give it up for R.E.G., everybody. Fantastic. Great. Great poet, and check out the Secret Pete's. Seriously, I don't I'm having some wonderful Punjabi deli. I don't know if people go to Punjabi Deli, the cab stand, but they have excellent, healthy, delicious food. It's superfood. It's got turmeric in it. It's all kind of vegetables. All right. I'm so sorry, I forgot my phone. It's Judah, right?
Exactly.
Let's get Judah up. Give a big, big, big round of applause for Judah making their open mic debut, everybody. Superstar Judah!
Okay. Woo! Woo!
Sorry.
I feel very special.
Sorry. Yeah.
Which. Any comments?
Some spinach, some potatoes.
My take on a Bateman impression.
Everything you're about to hear is 100% real.
How'd that compare?
Yeah.
But seriously, everything you're about to hear is 100% true, except the poem that I'm about to read. There's this quote that stuck with me recently. I don't know, everything sounds kind of tinny. My hair's kind of messed up. Because when I was outside, waiting to get in here, I was eating a slice of dollar pizza.
Yeah.
And a bird shit on my head. True story. And I did what any other person would do. I finished my slice of pizza. And then I washed my hair in the Japanese grill bathroom next door. So that's why my hair looks the way it does. This will come in relevancy later. The greatest thing a human soul can ever do on this earth is to see something and tell what it saw in a plain way. That wasn't me. That was John Ruxton, who is a 19th century philosopher, writer, poet, but now best known for his being absolutely terrified of female pubic hair. Also true. If you had to ask somebody a question, and it could only be four words, but you had to elicit the truth from them, what question would it be? I'm asking the audience here. Take suggestions.
Tell me the truth.
Tell me the truth.
What do you like?
What do you like? Come on, you can do some more.
Fuck me for real.
Fuck me for real.
That's not a question. Who do you love?
Who do you love?
What do you do?
What do you do? All great, great questions.
Which one's correct?
Boring.
There is no correct question.
Death.
But if you go to Washington Square Park on a nice day, just west of the fountain, you might find a chair. And that chair is empty. There's a table, and the other chair is me.
Oh, it's me.
Really?
Really. And I have a different sign, different prompts. I've been doing this for 4 years now, and I've talked to many, many people. And people always ask, what are you doing with this? And the answer is, I was really high and just wanted to meet more people. But the truth is, I think the city is beautiful.
Yeah.
It has so many people, and it's like an international airport, all in one place.
Yeah.
Yep.
However, what really the space is in that park is a place for people to be heard. No judgment. You're just an ear. It's listening. And a few weeks ago, this person named Di sat down. She was a classically trained oil painter. Think, you know, Vermeer, Rembrandt. We talked about everything and nothing at all. She was a very special person. And I wrote this loosely based on her. This is not the truth. The prompt that day, this is the truth, was called Tell Me Something Real. And she wrote, what does that say?
When you look at something, the wind is tearing me apart.
The wind is tearing me apart.
Yeah.
So she wrote. So I wrote this based on what she wrote. An artist's hand with a writer's heart. She finds herself at the mercy of gales beyond her grasp. the very same grip that depicts such beauty carves Mondrian marks down arms and down thighs. And despite a pandemic spent among the Mochong Mountains, the thin air failed to mend her broken wings. And so she stays crumpled, slowly adding layer by layer the oil that seeps from her onto endless canvas. In the perhaps vain hope that after the palette is rinsed for the final time, she'll realize that she is enough. I wrote this poem on the only page in my notebook that wasn't written on, because a bird had shat on it. What does it mean? Thank you.
Yes!
Judah Berger, everybody. Give it up for Judah Berger. Thank you for sticking around, hanging out. We've got a lot of great performers. We apologize to anybody going on late. It's like getting a reservation at Dorsia. You gotta get in early. You gotta get in early. That's all I can say. Message me now for next week if you wanna get on. But we've got a few more exciting acts. If you're still in the house and you're still going on, send me a message. We've got Zara coming up. Let's get Jordan Galland up to play some tunes for us. A great artist. And if you're still here and you wanna perform, just send me a message real fast or just tap me on the shoulder. We got a few more amazing artists coming. Thank you for hanging out.
Yeah.
Woo!
Thanks, Matt.
Yeah, I'm gonna do the piano. Try the piano.
Yes. Okay, what's your name again?
Adam.
Okay. We got him in this. Okay.
My first time I've been doing
something like this. Woo! Yeah. Try it now.
Yeah, check. All right, cool. Thank you. All right. I don't fuck this up. This song is called Green Umbrella. I wrote it a long time ago. It's sort of like I'm doing a piano cover of my own epic rock song. Let's try it.
Yes, Jordan.
That was a little fast. When I first saw her with a green umbrella, my first thought was I have to tell her. I have to tell her that my favorite color is green. Like you when you act all weird and too tough.
should take this. I think you're gonna need this green umbrella. I said, maybe I'm not laughing with you. Girls like you, you're kinda like the mafia. First you wanna make me an offer that I can't refuse. Just when we're off to a good start, you had to go and break a body part. I guess it might as well be my heart, cause that's the life I choose. I said, guys like me don't get too near to girls like you, not out of fear, but cause girls like you are way too much. Thanks, but no thanks, I don't need a souvenir. It'll be like I was never here. You're right, guys like me, we just disappear. Cause girls like you are way too much, and you're obviously a little nuts. So here, you can keep this. I ain't gonna need this green umbrella. There's nobody left out there. Oh, if you want the man of your dreams, better be prepared for a nightmare. Cause girls like me, we're everywhere, in every house, in every home. But guys like you need to learn not to care, when girls like me just need to be alone. But it's raining out there. Please take this. I think you're gonna need this green umbrella.
Woo!
Woo!
Thanks so much.
Woo!
Yes. Fantastic.
Woo!
That sounded great. Thank you.
Get it for Jordan Galland, everybody. That sounded phenomenal. Beautiful on the piano. Multi-instrumentalist, plays guitar, plays piano. Check out Land of Gal on Instagram. Has some amazing drawings from the Easy Paradise open mic. He draws amazing drawings of people. Okay, Jesus Christ. Let's get Joseph Sevier up. Can we? Joseph Sevier, and then we've got Adil K on deck. Adil K is on deck. Let's get Joseph Sevier up to play some tunes for us. And then we've got Adil K on deck, everybody.
Woo!
Yeah.
Thank you so much. I'm sorry. Apologies to anyone.
That's sweet.
Do you need a music stand or?
Okay, thank you.
That's the juice.
Yeah, I like reverb, like, you know, whoa. I've been here since 8:30, so I'm very drunk. If you want to buy me a beer, I appreciate it.
All right.
I like the IPAs. Motherfuckers. I'm finishing a song right now. So somebody earlier was reading some poems about rape, and I caught her as I was coming out of the bathroom, and I was like, hey, I'm playing a song about rape. And I was so excited about it. Like, it was totally normal. And then afterwards, I was like, you know what? That was pretty fucked up, you know? Even after a couple beers, I was like, I shouldn't have been that excited about that. I'm a fucking artist, all right? So this is, this song needs no more further introduction. This is called The Scorpion Song. So I used to live in the desert in Joshua Tree. I was on the subway today. Someone's wearing the scorpion necklace, and I was like, all right. And then I heard her recite that poem, and I was like, yep, I'm playing the scorpion song.
Yeah.
So here it is. Get a little more guitar on the monitor. Can't believe I went to the beach with you. I can't believe that I smoked weed with you. I can't believe I thought that was just the safest place to be at the time. But now I remember, you took my dreams away.
Woo!
You poured them out like a glass of water.
Yeah.
Took my dreams away. This is the end of imagination. And all the stars in the sky, with their white and blue, yeah, they cry for you. And all the angels in the trees, with their faces in the leaves, yeah, they cry for you. You took my dreams away. Poured them out like a glass of water. Will that field of grass, will it's dried and frayed, you might as well just light it on fire. 'Cause this is the end of imagination. You're not gonna remember this. I can't tell anyone. It's like a bomb that just goes off in all directions.
Yeah.
Well, there's people in the world that are supposed to keep you safe, not go doing that. You took my dreams away. You took my dreams away.
Yeah.
You tore the wings right off the dragon. His head. 'Cause this is the end of imagination. Now I'm a scorpion, and the moonlight is the only thing that guides me. The sun, it burns me now. You took my dreams away. Well, all this angels in the trees, well, they aim their heads and they cry for you. And all the dragons with clipped wings, well, they crawl out of their caves and they cry for you. My blood is poison now. I have no parents any longer. Now I'm a scorpion. You took my dreams away. You poured down my room like a glass of water. You took my dreams away. You took my dreams away. Thank you. I'm a band, it's called Joseph and the Sevier Dudes, S-E-V-I-E-R. I'm from Sevier County, Utah. If you want to know what hell is like, take a little visit, man. So we're playing at Orphan Guitars on Thursday, and I host a little residency showcase in Long Island City. So if you're interested in playing, be aggressive. All right, I'm Joseph the Severe Dude. Thank you very much. Right. Give a round of applause for the host, Matt.
Yes.
He's such a badass. You've earned my respect deeply.
All right. Yeah.
Hell yeah. Yeah.
Give it up for Joseph Severe, everybody. The feeling is very much mutual. Come back, Joseph Severe. We love having you guys. Sorry to put you on so late. We still got a great audience. There's still 20 people here. So you're still killing it. You're still gonna have a legendary, famous celebrity style breakthrough tonight. Can we get a DOK up to do so? This guy does a lot of great events. Check it out. The Do It Show, is that what it's called? And then also at Tiny Cupboard. Give it up for a DOK, everybody. A DOK is going to do some comedy for us.
You want to try that?
Oh, cream
of- oh yeah, all right. Yes, how are we doing, everybody?
Yeah.
Do you hear me?
Hear me.
How are we doing?
Yes,
we doing
I hear you.
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
Woo!
I'm doing a mic check right now. test 1, 2, 3. How's everyone doing? Everyone doing good? Yeah, give it up for Matt one time. Give it up for your fucking host. Give it up for your bartender. Please tip her. She's amazing. And give it up for all the performers you've seen tonight, man. Holy fuck. Just amazing. Mind-blowing. What an experience to be here. I guess you guys are probably all wondering why I'm wearing a lab coat. I'll tell you. Where do I start? My PIC... partner in comedy, he kept calling me Morty, so I had to bring out, yes, the drum and the kick, yes, I had to bring out the lab coat. You ever have to bring out a single linen of clothing out of your closet just for them in your relationship to know who is who in this dynamic duo, you know? You ever have to do that? No? Never had to establish? No, Morty, you fucking idiot. I'm the Rick C-137, motherfucker. Fuck you, Morty. You never had to do that? No? Alright, that's fine. I'll tell you the real origin story of the lab coat, though. When I was younger, I studied neuroscience. Like, that was, like, what I studied in college. Oh, thank you. I was fascinated by the brain. And the reason I was fascinated with the brain is because when I was younger,
my grandma was diagnosed with Alzheimer's. She had Alzheimer's, and I had to go visit her in the nursing home. And every time I'd go visit her, I'd be like, "Hey, Grandma!" And she would just shit the bed and ring the buzzer to the nurse and just be like, "Help, there's some little kid in here." And I'm just like, "No, it's your grandson." And then we'd play solitaire for an hour until she'd fall asleep. And then I'd have to do it all over again the next day. You know what I mean? It was an endless fucking cycle. Because she had Alzheimer's. She forgot. Yeah, if anyone didn't get it. So that's actually the origin story of the lab coat. If anyone was even interested, thought I should share that traumatic experience with all of you.
Yeah.
Okay. What did I want to talk about? Anybody believe in love in here? Anybody believe in love?
Yeah.
Woo! No. Fuck yeah! I love all of you guys. I do believe in love. I think love is blind. Marriage, eye opener. Am I right, fellas? Am I right? I wouldn't say I'm a hopeless romantic, though. Do you know that expression when people say they're a hopeless romantic? Does anybody know? You know what I'm talking about when people say they're a hopeless? Do you guys believe in that shit? I think that's kind of an oxymoron, you know? I think you need a little bit of hope to be a romantic. Otherwise, you're just sitting at home watching rom-coms and practicing making out with yourself in the mirror, you know? Just... I did practice that act out in the mirror before getting up. So I'm glad I'm entertaining all of you.
Yeah.
I don't know. I feel it's hard to tell somebody if you really love them that you love them. You ever have that gut-wrenching experience? That fear? Because like my biggest fear is telling some girl that I love her and then just her being like, "Oh, you fucking baby, you little wuss, grow the fuck up, you little bitch." You know, like that's like my biggest fear in life. And I gotta be like, "What, you don't believe in love and ooey gooey love, you know? You don't believe in that?" Alright. I used to play hockey. I was actually an enforcer. I played college hockey, and what's funny about that is okay, so my coach was like Pete Worrell. I don't know if you guys know who Pete Worrell is, but he played for the Florida Panthers. He was like the enforcer. He was like the one black hockey player that played for the Florida Panthers in the 90s and 2000s, and he was fucking awesome. He like kicked ass, you know? And so I always looked up to him, and he was my coach, and I played his position on my team, and he would get pissed when anybody would like go into the penalty box. I'm like assuming you guys all know what hockey is. I would get sent to the penalty box all the time because I would end up wrecking one of the players on the other team that would end up wrecking my player that was on my team, you know? So I'd get tossed in the penalty box all the time and every game pretty much. And my coach would get pissed whenever anyone would get in the penalty box, because we'd be a man down, they'd probably score on us, whatever. And then he would just bench me if I went back to the bench after. So whenever I got out of the penalty box and got back on the ice, I just ended up wrecking another player and then would get tossed out of the game because I didn't want to go back to the bench and then just get benched. So I was like, fuck it, might as well just watch the rest of the game in the stands, you know what I mean? You ever end up being a player mid-game and then become a crowd participant at the other half of the game, you know? That was pretty much my life in sports. Now since I do comedy, I kind of think sports is gay. Wow,
sorry.
Was some really bad feedback. but let me explain, man. I'm not saying being it's gay in a bad way. I'm saying it's great. You know, whenever I see a guy on the court smacking another guy's ass, I'm like, "Ah, that's gay." You know, it's good.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know. That's all right. Sweating up here. That's good. What else do I want to talk about? I don't know. I work as a barista.
Yeah.
And anybody work in the service industry? Show of hands.
Woo!
Show of hands. Anybody who works in the service industry? Fuck yeah. The real essential workers post-COVID.
Yeah.
I do feel like you get treated differently when you go to certain places, kind of like where you work, but you don't actually work there, you know? Like, I went to this other cafe the other day. It was called Cafe Reggio. Went to Cafe Reggio, and I went to sit down, and the server took my order. But immediately after he took my order, he just walks up to the manager, and he goes, "I don't want to do this anymore." And I don't know if he knew that I could hear him, but I just yelled out, "All I ordered was a croissant. What the fuck?" So, yeah, I have a good boss, though. I have such a good boss that sometimes it feels like I'm the boss. You know, like the other day, I was on break, and my boss, I come back inside, my boss comes up to me, and he goes, "Hey, man, so two customers ordered two tuna salad sandwiches, and I checked the receipt, and I thought they paid, but they didn't, and they just left." And immediately, I just threw down my rag, and I was just like, "What the fuck, man? I've been gone for 10 minutes, and people are ordering food and not paying for it. If this happens again, your ass is on the line." And then he still has his job, though, which is good, you know? And I still have my job, which is good. We both have our jobs, so it's good. But I think the best boss I'll ever have will just be any old Chinese lady, you know? I think she's been through way too much life experience for me to never listen to her, you know? She could beat the shit out of me. At the end of it, I'll just be like, "Shay Shay," you know? Like, that would be, like, the best experience. I guess I'll leave you guys with this. I like to go people watching. You guys go people watching?
Yeah.
I like to go people watching. It's like bird watching, you know?
Yeah, same
shit. But instead of throwing little pieces of bread at them, you just throw the whole loaf. I threw a whole loaf of bread at this dude's head one time. He was like, "Ow." I was like, "It's fucking bread. Get the fuck out." All right, good. Guys, you've been amazing. Thanks for having me. I'm just
woo! Yes! Hell yeah. That was awesome.
Thanks.
Give it up for DOK, everybody. He's got some great open mics. You should check him out. Joseph Severe, thank you guys for coming out. Come back next week. We love you. We love you. I'm going to sign you up for next week so you get on early,
right,
if that's cool. All right. Hell yeah. We've just got a few more acts left to go. Could I get Adam Branson up? And then we've got P. Ben Hefter on deck and Zara in the hole. If anybody else has not gotten to go, send me a message. Thank you for coming out. Give it up for Adam Branson, everybody.
Yeah.
Thank you. That was such a good welcome, guys. Thank you. That was awesome. Thank you for sticking around.
Woo!
I am so tired. I'm so fucking tired. It's so late. It's so late. This mic is so long. It just fucking just keeps fucking going. It's guy, girl, guy, girl, girl, guy. Sure. I like your fluffy coat.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Where'd you get it?
Speakin's closet.
Speakin's closet? Whose closet?
Their closet, man.
I'm telling you, that was not in my closet. I wish it was.
Speakin's closet, Soho.
Oh, okay.
Absolutely,
man. Stay
home safe. That's awesome. I was outside there. Right outside that exit door for a good bulk of the show out there. And the reason is because I was ripping ass.
Yeah!
I have IBS, I'm very Jewish. And I was dealing with that, I didn't want to be in here, it's kind of a closed area. It's a closed area, I didn't want to create like a gas chamber in here and just be ripping ass. And so I instead decided to stay in that very, very closed hallway and just be ripping ass over there. And so every time someone would leave, they would be leaving and just get a ripe whiff. All right, see ya, audio.
No, I'm staying. Oh,
thank you so much. Anyways, as I was saying, they'd get a ripe whiff of ass every time they'd walk out that exit door. And I was experiencing the show because it's a great show. There's so many different amazing people up here. They're so good. So many, yeah, sure, clap it up for all the amazing people. Most of them left. They're all gone. Adiel, Zach, you guys are my favorite two acts of the night. And the only reason I'm saying that is because you're still here. But I was experiencing the show through the crack in the door because of the whole ripping ass thing. So I would see the door open and I'd see a guy going, synagogue, synagogue. And the door would close and the door would open and I'd see Matt Silver like humping the microphone. And then the door would close and then the door would open and I'd see Zach bombing, doing his Bane voice. And then the door would close and then the door would open. And it's been a hell of a show though. I don't know if you can tell, but I'm just so fucking tired. I'm so tired. You guys are way better people than me because when I finish, I'm gonna fucking leave. I'm probably just gonna go straight home and go to sleep. I mean, it's a school night, you know? It's fucking Monday. The fact that you guys are out here, respect. This table right here, you guys seem like a good time. Did you guys have anyone perform? Anyone in your group?
Nah.
You just fucking came here just for the vibes?
Yeah.
You guys are living life, man.
Yeah!
You're fucking living life. I wish I was as happy as you guys.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm depressed. That's awesome, though. Yeah, I'm gonna go home and go to sleep. I can't wait to go to sleep. I'm so fucking tired. It's like 1:30. What is it? Tell me what time it is. 1:18. Are you fucking kidding me? 1:18? That's 3 hours past my bedtime.
I feel you, man. Dude, I take my sleep very seriously.
Dude, you get it. I feel like you've been giving me energy. That's why I'm directing a lot of my energy at you.
Oh, here you go.
Dude, I'm not gonna lie, it's not working, but I appreciate you trying.
My neuroscience, I'm not working well.
That's totally fine. I came up here with no plan. I had a full set. You guys should have seen it. My material would have fucking killed, but I'm just so tired. I'm so tired that I came up here. I was like, I'm just gonna fucking riff about how tired I am. I'll do one joke. We watching sex scenes with our parents? Yeah. It's a crazy thing, you know, you're watching a movie and the next thing you know, you're fucking, it's happening. These fucking actors are taking their clothes off and there's nothing you can do. You can't escape it. Sex scene with your parents, it fucking happens. This happened to me recently. I was watching a movie with my mom.
Nice.
I was watching a movie with my mom. It's called The Long Shot. Has anyone seen that? It's with Charlize Theron and Seth Rogen. And there's this scene in the movie where Seth Rogen, that's the French way, he's jacking off, man. He's fucking yerking his chain. And he's jacking off and he comes into his beard. And I know you're thinking, did he come up into the air and then he's looking up and then it falls into his beard like that? Or did he come straight into his beard like a straight rocket straight up? And it was the latter. It was the straight up. And I'm watching this with my mom, right? And she had the audacity to turn and look at me and say, has that ever happened to you? And I'm not a liar. So I was like, yeah. And I'm not gonna lie, I don't really have a punchline to that joke yet, but I just feel like I needed to tell you guys about it. I needed to come on stage and air my grievances about this situation with my mom. I'm so fucking tired, guys.
Go to sleep, man.
I love you guys. I'm gonna leave immediately.
Yeah.
Have a great night.
Yeah.
I'm Adam Bramson.
Give it up for Adam Bramson. Hilarious. That was actually very funny. Thank you for coming out. Thank you for hanging out. We've got just a couple more amazing acts. This is my book, 1 Year. I wrote one line a day, every day, for a year. That's right, I do this at every open mic. Thank you, Ashley and Aiden. I'm just going to read one line real fast. Fantastic, that's right. April 24th. This is the line for today, April 24th. Doesn't seem right to meta-contemplate the swallowed walls. That's right, everybody. Yeah. 1 Year. Get it at your local bookseller. All your finest booksellers carry this. This is a product of Rockcore Incorporated. Can we get P. Ben Hefter up? We've got Zara on deck. Zara, P. Ben Hefter, if I'm missing anyone, please send me a message. We're going to be closing it out. Coming up. I love P. Ben Hefter. He's got a tape recorder.
Hi, everybody.
Woo!
Happy birthday, Shakespeare.
Yeah!
I went to Dia Beacon today. Have any of you guys been to
Dia
Beacon?
Oh, hell yeah!
Oh, my God!
Woo! We love Dia Beacon.
First museum that I've been to where I, like, cried. I was moved. I was like, these oblong shapes are bringing something out. I'm going to test something really quickly.
Hell yeah!
Can we hear this?
Yeah!
Great.
Woo!
Yeah.
Hell yeah.
All right, let's do this. I have to make sure I... Yeah. Cool.
This is the last song that I wrote.
Yeah.
It's not well rehearsed, so we'll see how it goes. The ice box in my freezer is failing. The grass sprout in the back begun to run. The other.
Finished recording my album.
Yeah!
So that's coming out soon.
Woo!
How's this? Follow me on Instagram. Frogthroat NYC. Big things coming. Good night, everybody.
Woo!
Wow.
That was beautiful. That was really amazing.
Give it up for P. Ben Hefter. That was amazing. Really, I was touched. I almost started crying. That was so beautiful. All right, we're closing it out. We just have one performer left. Thank you all for hanging out. This is the Book of the Week. It is One of a Kind by Jack Michelin from Ugly Duckling Press, edited by Julian Poirier, one of my favorite poets. Jack Michelin, check him out if you don't know him. He's a street poet. Can we get Zora up to close us out? The great Zora, thank you for hanging out. Give it up for Zora, everybody. That beautiful coat.
Hi. I usually like sell the room in Brooklyn, but now we're in Manhattan.
Woo!
Okay. I've never performed in Manhattan before.
Yeah.
Woo! Arima, yes. I'm counting on you. I'm getting evicted in like a month. Okay. New York. All the times I've had sex.
Yes!
We had sex like Catholics too. Very kinky Catholics. Which Eileen Miles tells me is most Catholics. Anal sex, maybe, really just everything but penetration.
What?
Me close to you, rubbing bodies, a big tongue in my mouth. I will never forget your hairy ass. And I say that lovingly. We never spoke the word love. Love would have broken it. You were always this weirdest guy, and I seemed to be on the surface, extroverted and bright like a surveyor bear, and I was just like you, scared, and you helped me belt my shit out.
Yeah.
I remember your girl jumping on the top of your back, hitting you and punching you, and I was just laughing, and I knew I found something I wanted to do. I used to not love people, but just what I could do to them. Mm. I wanted to have sex like a wild animal.
Yes.
I wanted to have sex like a wild animal, have someone that was not afraid of my strength, my animal urges, my wildness. Although you were always scared of me, going further, surpassing our gender binary, breaking the binary in all the way that you could.
Woo!
Long eyelashes, I remember them still.
Woo!
The second time I've had sex. I've had sex that turned someone into a punk. He whispered in my ear that all the girls I usually know want to have date. They want to have kinky sex. They expect a linear timeline of his loyalty to them. But me, I'm free. That impressed him.
Woo!
I could be as dominant as I wanted to be. Spit sex in the church, sex in my parents' bed while they were gone. Yeah, I mean, you remember this. Queen size, I remember. I could pretend I was an adult and a whole huge loft just for us. He did caffeine pills and I told him, oh honey, and I showed him Molly. He was running a punk underground a year after. I saw him chip purple fingernails, mascara and eyeliner on his eyes, ordering and trying to rein in the punk chaos, burning trash cans and Marxism. He was one of us now. He may have taken my virginity, but I showed him love, sex, and rock and roll.
Yeah!
Woo! Okay. I've had sex to distract myself from not loving someone. I had sex because, like in Eileen Miles' novels, I was scared I would not be whole with you. My first queer experience, and all my friends were cheering me on. Alina was one of them. My first queer experience, and all my friends were cheering me on. You were up front, but scared of my wildness, scared of going further than anyone else, scared of sex in public. While we were sitting in the subway, you were just scared that I took my bra off, but I took my bra off anyways. I had sex with a man to distract myself from not loving you. I don't remember the guy. I think I remember the guy. I had sex with the... a weird memory of making me be feminine, knock down door, screams, me finally screaming into the closed hallway, you all respect me, and I meant it. I should have screamed at you, but not that you didn't respect me, but I screamed at you the wildness that I had inside of me. I should have screamed at you, you all respect me!
Woo! Yeah!
I should have had sex with you to not feel more feminine, but instead, I felt more feminine than ever before and out of my body, trapped in a cocoon of a dress, a cocoon of cake, a cocoon of flirting to know the most, I was the most attractive ass they could ever touch, yeah, trapped in a way where I couldn't find out to dominate them, not even dominate them, but let the wildness out in every way, consenting in every way, screaming at the top of our lungs for freedom! Okay, yeah. It's funny, Eileen Miles has another poem where this happens to her. They try to smoke in bed while having sex. He didn't want me to smoke, so I got on top and smoked instead, knowing that you wouldn't want to stop it. I was a dirty shame, hiding me to hide how submissive they had been. There can also be sex when you're both submissive and dominant, where you see the fireflies at night turning to stars and vice versa. And you don't even drink, where I pretend to blush and you let me, although we both know I have no shame. But without pretending, without games, what are we? Where I pretend like I have no shame, I'm like, oh no, that's not gonna happen. I know that if I pumped, I could get up on stage right now, also this stage in Manhattan, and be with so much as blood coming out! And it wouldn't be demeaning, it wouldn't feel wrong, it feels more wrong to be ever trapped in the cocoon of femininity, where every hand I feel is that's touched ass, where I feel like you feel your hands on my ass feeling cake, and instead I feel like I'm dominant, instead I feel like I feel like there's hands on my cocoon feeling cake, and I feel like, no, that's not it. Okay. Progressive stimulation, spiritual stimulation, edging, yoga, breathing deep, in and out. Whatever rocks your boat. I am done with having a little voice in my head telling me how I can make an experience more palatable so men can like me, how I can bring them into my sexuality to try excuse who I am and what I feel. I am a dyke, but I like dick too. Woo! Bisexuals in the audience, okay.
Yeah.
No more little voices in my head.
Woo!
Maybe I like Eileen Miles so much because of that, because she created a world where all we need to think and imagine is dykes and trans bodies, non-binaries, and smoking with your lovers. I gave the novel to someone I danced with hard at a noise show. Now this reference is really fucked up.
Yeah.
Without expectations. I just want to exist and breathe in a world where all we have is that imagination. The imagination outside of the cocoon.
Wow! Yes! Zora, everybody! Eileen Miles! We're here every Monday! Did you love it? We love it! Next week, baby, we are Easy Paradise. We're living it, we're loving it, we're trying it. Easy Paradise cannot be rebroadcast without the express written consent of Rockport International. Thank you for watching. It's Pecan Celery. I'm just gonna finish it out with this. This is a Shakespearean sonnet, everybody. This is Venus and Adonis. This is As You Like It. This is 12th Night, Much Ado About Nothing, Philip, Midsummer Night's Dream, we're living it, we're living Shakespeare, King Lear, Hamlet.
winner was a mere interruption in the hot spring air, making everybody come too fast. Making everybody come too fast. Being straight makes me gay. Fucking hot chicks, a whole new original series. Lauren Michaels cast me. Lauren Michaels, I need an audition. I need a paycheck. I need a check. I need a Venmo transaction. Somebody buy my checkbook. I buy my poetry. I listen to my music. Baz Luhrmann, call me, okay? We'll try to do better the next time, everybody. We love you all. It's Easy Paradise. We're amateurs. Hey, hey. We're having sex. We're getting naked. We're doing drugs. We're drinking alcohol. Yeah, 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 yeah. Nina Simone. Nina Simone. Yeah. Sam Shepard, Rolling Thunder, Patti Smith, is Patti Smith out there? We're just kids, we're falling in love, we're living the romantic dream, we're poets of the goddamn greatest city in the world, baby! We're bohemians, we are changing the language from the inside, we're destroying the government, We're turning the tables on the status quo, baby! Jazz! Jazz, 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 jazz! Thank you all, everybody. I'm Matt Proctor. This has been Easy Paradise. Go out and be merry. Are you touching my music? Do not touch my music. We love you all. Yes, that corporate banjo. I am the Bible. Wind knocked out of me. I respect women. I respect women by leaving them alone. I respect women by leaving them alone. I respect women by leaving them alone.
Hey, I went to college once.
Can you skip this commercial? Press it. Press it. I'm all about, you better revive the inner filmmaker.
As any bum on Main Street, that's how she operates.
Pieces of autumn, wine animals, letters to gloss, goodbye everybody, thank you for watching. Once again, Easy Paradise cannot be rebroadcast without the express written consent of the National Football League. Copyright 2023 Rockcore International.
This is Paul.
This is Paul.
Ashley.